to the summer turn. 44, it's the Allies' turn. And we're going to definitely move our airplanes up here now. We're going to get in a fight right here. It's time for another carrier battle. And I'm going to try to attack this way. Both attacks same time. I don't have time to mess around. And I'm going to be building up here for a push this way. I'll probably come here and into here. Russians are going to go all out on offensive and break through the German line. I'd like to cut off this area. The Allies, they've already got on the beach. We're going to reinforce it and probably take another beach there. And we're going to do diplomacy with Vichy France, try to get them out of the way. Okay, for turn two, we go up 40 there. We drew magic and we did research. The Axis still had to research covert. And they missed. They rolled a one. The Allies, Americans, wanted to research their code breaking. They rolled a one and missed. However, in the diplomacy phase, we put five into Vichy France. The Axis put three, but we got a modification of a five for the invasion there, going first. So Vichy France deactivates, except for the French colonies here. They are free French. So that's it. We remove these forces from the board. I make naval base change from here to here, and I tell the Germans I am sea transporting troops into this port and probably this port. But the base change I have there, do you want to stop them? No. So we move to the combat phase. You can see how quickly this develops with two turns here. Everything that was invaded here moved up around Paris. Paratroopers dropped. Aircraft are in. I haven't used this, and I didn't use these ships. The Germans came across. They want to try to stop this force. It's the smaller force, and it's the same interception die roll. They want to stop this. They have to get anything but a six. Here they go. And it's a one. They succeed. My interception's automatic. These ships that I didn't use intercepted them right there in the North Sea. So let's get on with this battle. And I'll come back and show you our losses. That battle, the Germans went demolished them. We lost all kinds of ships. But look what you do. You dwindle the Germans down. Now they continue on and they go after this force. So the Germans succeeded in defeating two Allied forces, and they sunk enough ships where they destroyed an American infantry corps, and the others returned home. So a lot of ship battles going on, but the Americans are sucking up most of the losses. Anyways, we'll see if that's enough to stop the battle. We still have an air-to-air battle to do right here with the jet. And what you do with this now is the jet represents three air factors, and he gets to attack at an airstrike. In other words, these planes can't do anything to the jet. So let's see. So the jet attacks, and it aborts three aircraft and destroys one. Only one is left, which will now fight the 2-4. So the Germans receive a plus one in this air battle size, and the Germans and the Americans tied, so we rolled again. The Americans lost one air factor, and so did the Germans. So the Americans just lost a full five air wing going after this jet. Now, they still have jets here, but the jets aren't allowed to do anything but intercept Allied air. So, luckily. Now, the British also done an offensive, which they pay for in this front. There's the red line. And the invasion is in this western front. So they already paid, and we invaded with two British infantry. The ships come from here, and they travel this way, out of range of their air. And if their ships come out, I've got like 20 aircraft here. It's a ridiculous thing for the British to try to do. So, I mean, the Italians. So they don't. They just don't want the Allies getting roamed. But now, if this whole front opens up, everything's vulnerable up here. We have to start backing up. So you can see what two turns in a row does. It just opened this up. But the Germans have a lot of power here. They can do something. These forces here, or these hexes, belong to the Allies. That's why I put them there. These are all cut off. They won't be able to move. I'm going to send in... Now, the Germans used their ships to stop the invasions, and I have this many left. I left up there, and I'm going to bring in some Americans, and I'm going to SR them down in here. Okay? I deployed 4 units. I still have those I bought. One was a fleet, it's upside down. One was a replacement, which is 3 ship SR'd. And one was a 3-4, which those 7 ships SR'd, they come into this port. The partisan I had here occupies this hex. It keeps the Germans from getting 2 hexes here on Paris. I built another partisan because I don't want these infantry coming around and opening up a supply route to those guys. So, partisans come in handy. And that's what we got. The Russians did some damage on the Germans here, it looks like. The Japanese. Now, the first thing you do is any naval movements, run supply. We ran supply here with 4 ships to protect. He chose not to do anything about it. And we ran supply here without any protection, and he didn't do anything about it because I'm counter-airing. Remember, I supplied this, so last turn I had planes there. I'm counter-airing the 3 he had there. This one. Here, I attacked counter-airing that one, and I'm providing air cover to this force. In case he tries to bring air out on me. Other than that, I've got 6 aircraft still sitting right here and 2 task force what he sees. So it's up to the Japanese what they're gonna do. The Japanese decide they're going for it. This is the time now. This is what you're saving your carriers for. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now, here's my missions. He sees a task force go here and here. If I was a Japanese, I'd think, okay, this can't have a lot. He just wants to get on those beaches. And then task force 2 is going there, which looks like an invasion force. This guy has 1, 2, 3, 7. We got 2 task force coming out here. This is the Battle of Java Sea. I say I am attacking that. I am going to counter intercept with these 2. Here, the Japanese are going to attack this one. Because if he stops this supply to the port, the supply has to come over here. The infantry are only going to be able to walk this far, and he still won't have these for a turn. He can take that beach. Well, he can put a beachhead there. But we're going to stop him on this one. And these 2 planes, no, I will not. We'll just have to go with that. And they'll intercept at that port. Let's roll for the interceptions. We have 1 going here. These 2 forces are going after that. And then I have counter interceptions right here. They're Japanese aren't going to use their aircraft. They're going to use it for the battle to search. So I'll come back with the rolls. So, it's 7 hexes to here. And he has 1, 2, 3 in range of it. And he has to get a 4 less. So they both succeed. They're there. Oh, sorry. Only 2 within range. So they both succeed. Mine are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I need anything but a 6. 1 made it, and 5 made it. This side, he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 is, he needs anything but a 5 or a 6. And he made it. And we have no other interceptions there. So all the interceptions made it, And let's do our counter error. Here's Americans and Japanese. Japanese are black dice. And it's a 2. Americans are losing. The Japanese don't lose nothing. Let's roll our next one right there. And it's a 6-2. So the Japanese lose 4. They only have 3. And Americans only lose half of that. Okay. This battle we'll conduct first. It'll be the easiest. Task Force 3 against Task Force 3. I just put them on the board. There's what's in Task Force 3. One combat group. And he says one combat group for him too. Well, he don't say it, but it's divided up on the board. Now, unbeknownst to each other, nobody knows what's in each other's forces. So we roll to search. So the Americans are going to roll according to their search. They get to add 2 to it. One for the combat group and one because of a friendly air base in range. 5 plus 2 is a 7. They get combat group 1, and they get another one because this is carrying out an activity. So 2 to his die roll is a 4 is a 6. So it's a 7 to a 6. So the 6, into the search, I find out what he has. I see he has no carriers and fleets, and he finds out that he don't know what I have, but he's located all my combat groups, and I only have 1, he's told. So, the surprise level is a 1. Airstrikes. It has nothing to do with ours. So, now we can do this 3 times and wait for something good. So, we either search again or we engage. And we're going to search again. Here's the Americans. They rolled a 6. Here's the Japanese. A 6. So that's still the same. Americans. A 3. Japanese. A 1. So the difference now is a 2. And there's still nothing. So that's 3 rounds. The surface units engage. So let's get in a surface battle. Americans lost 2 ships sunk. 3 were aborted. The Japanese only lost 1 sunk, 3 aborted. The Americans withdrew. They didn't lose their infantry. They go home with 7 ships. So that's it. The Japanese succeeded in stopping the Lei invasion. Japanese, we made 4 combat groups with carriers in the first and the second, and half of their planes on cap, the rest on naval units. The Americans, we did 3 combat groups with carriers and surface fleet in the first one, but not in the second. Half their planes on cap. And this last carrier group is just to really make up a 3rd combat group. So the die roll for the Japanese. We're going to use 1 magic point on them. He has 4 combat groups plus a search and a search. So, a 2. With 4, with a 6, that's an 8. He got a search level of an 8. Let's see what the 4, 5, 6, but he has to reduce 1. Sorry, that's a 5. So, search level of a 7. And let's see what the allies get. Allies have a 3 with a search level of 3, 4. So 4 and 3 is also a 7. So it's actually a tie. So there is no surprise. Now you note I put 1 strike for land base, 1 strike for land base, 1 strike for land base. Or actually all their planes there. I'm not even trying to protect this strike force. That's because I won't get magic next turn. I want to reduce this anything to help me keep reducing his search modifier. This one would be an easy one to destroy, so that's why we're going to strike that one. Anyways, we'll get on with the naval battle. The search modifier 7 says you have to tell him the fast carrier is an enemy combat group 1. So he knows now there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 fast carriers there. And he knows in mine there's 1, 2, 3, 4 fast carriers. And then combat groups 1, 2, and 3 may attack. So both of his are attacking and all 3 of mine are attacking. You use all lesser results, so all enemy combat groups are located, and I can attack any one of those. Now another thing I might do as an American is he has a lot of combat groups. If I want to sink some carriers, but if I knock this down a little bit, he doesn't get the search modifier for later rounds, so I might do that. I have this amount of factors striking the land base. What you do is you make a surprise roll for the land base to see if they're surprised. So it's just a separate roll. And wow, it's a 6. Enemy defenses in disarray. No fleet and base air defense die rolls. So the base doesn't even get a defense die roll. The enemy defenses in disarray. No fleet and base air defense die rolls. So the enemy cap air combat attacking waves occurs after the air attacks. We get a plus 1 on our air attack roll. There's no air defense roll. So that's it, man. So that was a good search. He can still counter air. Remember, aircraft that are used to search, what they were used to search for this battle, can still defend their base. So they still get to defend. But he can't fight him until after the air attack. So let's go ahead and attack. 2, 3, 4. And I just rolled an 8. And with 4 factors. And it's 2 factors eliminated. And I'm over 4. I get to add 1. Oh, it don't matter. The defense aircraft is eliminated. Note. Seeing how the search turned out, I would have liked to have more of my units on cap. And that's why I don't like playing behind a screen. If this had a screen like this against the other guy, you constantly have to put your hands in here to see where your stuff's going. And then the guy's always putting stuff in there, and he can just switch after the die roll's made. I don't like it. I don't trust him. I don't trust people for the fact that it's just too easy to do it. It's tempting to me. And so I have these cups, and everything goes in a different cup, and there's no way you should be touching the cap where you put your cap or your strikes until you bring them out to do the fighting. So it never gets switched. Anyways, that's done. Let's go on with the battle. There's no surprise. So we're just going to strike first. So let's start with the Japanese. Because of their search, they know how many fast carriers are having combat group 1. So they're going after combat group 1. This is my cap protecting it. And this is the enemy force striking my combat group. So I'm allowed to attack, pick how many units I want to go after. I have 6, 7, 8. Now since we're fighting over water, these do not get changed into naval air factors until after the battle takes place. So it's only 2 factors. So it's 6, 7, 8. And I want to pounce on 5 of these. Now he can choose which 5 to go after me. And he's not going to use his elite. He'll go ahead and pick 5 regulars. Like that, okay? So we're going to go for the combat battle. It's a 5, 2, and 8. That means I have a plus 3 to my dice roll. And that's 4 and 3 is 7 to his 2. So he loses 5 factors. So I successfully shot down all 5 air units. And I lose half of that, which is 3. And these two will remain on cap duty. And now they go in and attack the fleet. And now you get an air defense factor. That is air defense roll. For every 9 fleet factors, including damaged ones, and we're just sitting at 9. So it's a 1. And we're out in the water, so you have for each Army air factor or 3 naval air factors surviving a counter-air attack during the current round of an air attack against a port. So it's not that. But you do get to add each factor in that are protecting the ships. So he gets 3, and you can't add land-based air to defense. So I get 3 plus the 1 for the ship is a 4. So my defense is a 4. So with the roll of a 5 and with 4 factors, I shot down another plane and I boarded one. So this one goes home. So this is what is remaining to attack the carriers. And I think I'm going to split them up. We're going to go after this carrier and this carrier. Carrier defense is a 1. So here we go. 3. And that's nothing. And the other one is a 10. And we shot down another plane. So the 2 shot down an elite one. It gets removed and replaced with a regular one. 3 are attacking this carrier. And they get a plus 1 for being elite. So the air attack table is 3. Any other factors? No, just a plus 1 for Air Force nationality. And it looks like a 5 on 3. And it's damaged. They destroyed one factor, damaged one factor. So that one is still around damaged. The airplanes go back, and now these two attack the carrier, and that is a, and they rolled a 7. That's 6 factors, and that eliminates that carrier. So this carrier is sunk, and these go home. This carrier's damaged, it's still there. It can be attacked by submarines now. See, if the Japanese would have left their submarines, not worried about this reinforcement over here, they would come out and attack that carrier now and sink it. So, just a good note. Save your submarines most of the time for the carrier battle. Okay, so, especially when the enemy has forces, if you know he has ships here to take up the losses of your submarine attacks out here, then why do it? In this instance, in a combat group, when he specifically goes after that damaged carrier, you don't take the losses off here at all. They immediately come off of the carrier. So the American damaged naval unit is immediately returned to port. Oh, and this one came out of Task Force 1. So it is there damaged, where it automatically gets repaired next round. Anyways, that is the Japanese attack. We have 1 sunk heavy carrier and 1 damaged light carrier. And let me get out the American attack now. Comes the American attack. It's these planes. Here's the cap that's out there. And these 5 are going to take on these 3. And these 5 are going to take on another 3. So they're going after 6 of these planes. So right here when we roll, They outnumber them by 2, so it's a plus 2 plus elite. It's a plus 3 to the black dice. And a 3 and a 3 is a 6. So it's 2 aircraft eliminated. So second one is the same thing, plus 3 to the black dice. And he has an 8 to a 4. That's 4 dead. So all 3 American planes are destroyed here. And the Japanese lose 1. And the Japanese lost 1 out of here too. So the Japanese ended up losing 2 elites. And that is it with the cap. And now these continue on the attack. They get an air defense roll of 1 fleet. And they get to add how many cap factors they had. So it's 5, 6, 7, 8. So he has 8 surviving cap that will add to that defense. So let's see what he has. And so here goes his air defense roll of a 5, 6, 7, 8, of a 9. His level's a 9. And he just rolled a 3. Air defense level 9. He shot down 2 and aborted 1. So shot down 2 and aborted 1. So this is what is remaining. And we want the heavy carriers, boys. That's how we're going to divide it. He does have that CB4. I won't take it yet. I want 2 regular carriers. That'll jack them enough. We're going after those 2. Now they get a carrier defense roll. Oh, and they get to add 1 because of the research to the die roll. So 1 carrier is a 4 is a 5. Nothing. And the other carrier is a 2. Is nothing. So here we go. 5 attacking this 3. And I just rolled a 10. And it's 3-4. That eliminates the carrier. There we go again. Oh, and only a 3 on the other one. With an air attack of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And we only got a 3. So it's 1 factor destroyed and 3 damage, which would go on that. So we have a damaged carrier right here. Now here, the Americans didn't use all their submarines. The Japanese carrier, which is damaged, is trying to return back to their port in the Philippines. And as it's returning, it's getting hit by 4 submarines. His air defense is 1. Submarine defense is 1. He just rolled a 9. And he just sunk 1 submarine. 1 submarine out. 3 attacked that carrier. And I just rolled a 10. Because the Americans and their submarines were not as, their torpedoes were not as good as the Japanese, you have to minus 1. So that's a 9 at 3 attack table. And we just went 1 factor damaged, 2 more factors damaged. So this ship returning has 2 factors eliminated. It has 1 factor left, and I just got rid of another full factor and 3 damaged ones. So the Shokoku sinks by submarine attack. And these submarines go back to SW duty. Now, one note I didn't make is any of the ships that take losses from onboard activity which were damaged have to get out of the SW box and return back to their home base. Very successful attack. Let's see what's happening in round 2. The Japanese have lost one of their search modifiers here. They have one left. And they can keep their combat groups. They just lost two heavy carriers. The Americans obviously lost a couple, and there's still one there. They got a couple more in the force pull. And they do have one magic point left. Now, it's the Japanese just see they have a chit left because they used one right now, and there's one that's hasn't been used. They don't know what it is. It could turn out worse for the Japanese. So the Japanese decide to retreat and withdraw from the battle. They put up a fight. They'll let it go on. So Task Force 2 now hits the beach unmolested. This aircraft has been used to search. It can defend its own base, so we'll leave it like that, but it can't be used to support the battle. These ones were used to provide air cover, so these are still available. They fly out. So I have 6, and 6 is 12. And this gives ground support, which is 13. It costs 18 to move those guys. So there's 6, 7, 8. So those were carrying the units. I have 7 left for shore bombardment, which I need 6. So there's 2 more. So it's 2, 3, 6 is 9. 9 and 6 is a 15. I got a 15 hitting this. 2 times, you get 2 on defense, 1 for the beach, 1 for the jungle. So it's 2 times 4 is 8. So 8 is a 16. I got 15, and these are attacking. So out of all this, I have 16. It is 2 to 1. Die roll, please. 3, counterattack. 3, counterattack. Tough battle raging at the beach, and it's an exchange. All in all, a tough battle just to get a piece of land here, but it gives me air base now to Balakpopkin and this one. That's what I want, so we'll see how the Japanese try to defend this. Remember, his ships are used, so there's nothing he can do on his turn. He used everything. And spent another 70 here, 70 over there. They spent 140 BRPs on unit construction. And they're going to send 20 to Russia through the Lend-Lease. Okay, so actually used out of their American 17 SRs, I used about 11 of them, maybe I think 12, quite a bit. And I used 3 initial deployments here and 5 on the European board. This is quite a setup we have here. I had 2 that were not flexible deployment last turn, so they waited. So now they're in the box, and I sent 3. I'm allowed to do 3, and I sent 3 in there. All this gets SR'd right here into Australia, ready to go. So seeing how this works very well, it would probably help the Japanese. Now, they got as far as Port Moresby and Guadalcanal, but because of fear of basing their fleets right here, they kept them back in truck, and they weren't able to cut off the SRs. So I think in the future, we need to devise a plan with the Japanese to move the carrier task force at least to Rabaul. When Port Moresby's taken, the task force can go to here and base it right there, or even here at Naomi. Now, the problem I had with this is the Americans can still come around to this side, and they already had forces here, and they can go this way. To put my task force out of range for this makes it easier for the Americans. That's the problem you have. So even though you cut it off from getting to Australia, you can't protect it here and do there, so you would have to still divide your forces somewhat. Maybe lesser force here to cut the interceptions. That's what I would do. token force here to at least put up a fight, and the main force over there. That's what we'd have to devise with the Japanese. I think taking Port Moresby was a lot to handle. It'd probably be easier just to go out of canal and invade this. It's not really overextending yourself. I don't have to put my aircraft out here to win a naval battle if I'm just trying to intercept him. So we can work on that. Anyways, let's just finish the British and Chinese turn here. Another tactic. See how this base is newly taken? Well, at the post-combat phase, if you want to keep this supplied so you can advance your aircraft into it, you run supply to it. The Japanese have to cut it. Or if you can't run supply, the Japanese are still able to cut it at the end of the combat phase. Therefore, see, we used every ship's all the ships in the battle. From now on, if I'm the Americans, I gotta hold some back to watch the supply, and the Japanese should hold one some back to watch supply or cut it, and the same with me. So we gotta remember to do that. So that is the Americans' movement. Just to let you know, the British, the infantry that invaded last turn, they walked on the port, took it, and then went up this way. What I'm trying to do is cut off these German units right here. These, the two Italians, and these. By taking this, which I will own all this, they can't get supply this way, and then I'm going to exploit some American tanks around this way. It's not very strong, and Germans could be able to get it back, but that's what I want to do. The jets can't stop ground support. They're too fast. They don't fly low enough. So the ground support, I can always give the ground support. However, if I leave my aircraft in range, he can counter-air my aircraft. And I don't want to do that. The jets are going to kill a lot of my aircraft. So then second, when he flies his defensive air support out to help his troops, and I try to intercept his defensive air support, his jets can stop me. So that's one role that the other normal planes can't do that jets can do. So basically, I have to put enough aircraft on my attack hex to cover his normal aircraft he has. Remember, his jets don't count. His jets don't count for the defensive air support, but he has one aircraft there, two there, five there. This one don't reach that hex. He can put seven on that. So I have to put enough for my 2-to-1 plus seven extra factors to cover his defensive air support if he comes in. So that's what the jets are doing to me. They're making me use a lot of air. Anyways, that's it for that. And we'll continue with the combat here for the Americans and the British. Go ahead and not build yet because I'm not sure what I'm building over there for the Americans. But we're going to conduct one SR here because it's going to constitute some fighting. And move the British ships down here. They're going to pick up these tanks because I'm in a deadlock here and I'm going to travel this way. And I'm doing a counter air here. And we're going to SR into this port that I just took because I want the tanks here to cut this off. Now, the Italians didn't use their ships on it, but at this rate, the Italians have to protect up here now before their surrender. They're not really protecting too much down here anymore. The Allies aren't going this way. So they may well use the Italian fleet right now. I mean, what are they going to wait for? I'm saving them for that one good shot when the British were trying to maybe invade in this area, but it doesn't look like it's happening. If I'm an Italian player, I'll go ahead and use them right now. I let him pick up these troops because why fight him before he picks up the troops? Because if I win the battle, I can eliminate the tank. So now that he's taken off here for an SR, we're going to get in a battle. The British are countering this air, so there's no aircraft for the Italians, but the British have all kinds of aircraft. That's the only thing that's a little sketch is all the aircraft that the British have. The Italians really don't have a chance, but what are you saving your fleet for? You might as well use it. Because I think it's a couple turns now that the Italians are going to be done. So the British, this is what really hurts the British. They only have three SRs because of those dumb subs. So one of them is going to be this infantry I need in the front. And then I SR'd these two tanks. I built one partisan, put it there. and I built 15 aircraft, so I got more British planes up there now, but I can't SR these planes and ships away from 10 air factors if they want to come down and do some damage to them. But you know what? I'll take the hits here. As long as we don't lose Sicily, he can't do anything with ships. And I got Messina protected. That's the way it's got to go. So it was a big, heavy battle. There was at least, 10 Italian ships lost. 5 Italian aircraft lost. The British lost 8 aircraft and 3 ships. So, big battle right there. But the troops got through, and that's all the British cared about. So we are going to wait on the unit construction for the Americans and the SRs. The one SR the British has left, and then all the American SRs coming from up there. Okay, let's move to the Russians. We did a little exploitation trying to open a gap up there in the north. I took 3 1-to-1s. 2 of them succeeded in exchanges. 1 of them failed, which was up there. But I bought back a lot of stuff. The Russian force pull, I would still like to get those tanks, but I did buy the paratrooper this turn. He's sitting right behind Moscow. I don't know, the German line's looking pretty weak, especially down here. And I bought another aircraft, so I am gonna start equaling the Germans in air now. So we gotta hurry up though. Oh, that's it for the Russians over here. We'll move to the Americans on this side. The big thing here going on is now the way the supply works is initial supply phase from last turn when I had things supplied, which was this. Then this after the battle is supplied. All the ships were spent. He couldn't do anything about it. So post-combat gets supplied. Everything stays in supplied until the end of the initial supply phase. So right now you're in supply. Now if I want to go till next turn, I have to supply it right now, but as of right now, they're in supply. This hex is in supply, this is in supply, so I can move my air up and use them. But if I don't supply them right now, I don't get those next turn. So we may go for a big supply battle here because I want to keep this supplied. I don't know. I may not. I'm thinking about evading down in this way, staying away from his carriers as much as possible, even though I think I gave him a good whooping last time. So as far as the carrier battles goes, it's 1-to-1. But he did send down his air all in this area. He's protecting more up north, but I might have to switch this way. I'll think about it, and we'll go on. I still want to keep up the pressure here because I want to get my bombers going. I got to get in at least into Guam here. I might just bypass truck and go to Guam where it's not being protected. We'll see. Because now that I own I don't own this port yet. It's still not within 10 of Guam. This one would be. Yes, if I take this port, I can get into Guam. Okay. Japanese chose not to stop the supply. He's, you know, if I'm the Japanese, I'm figuring, look, they're already getting in here. Why waste my ships here? I need to still hold on to my resources. We went for the counter airs. The Japanese came out ahead. The Japanese lost 4 aircraft. The Americans 6 aircraft. We did destroy 1 naval aircraft over here on this island. We advanced up here. We're taking New Guinea. I want to get this port. From this port, this makes this vulnerable. He has to protect it. Down here, Task Force 1's my main force. I hold it back to watch those. These two Task Force are invading Batavia. Task Force 4 ran the supply to there in a task force. He don't know how much it is. It got, and he didn't stop it. So we went for all the counter airs. Now he's thinking about doing something to this task force. He needs a 1 or a 2 to make this interception. He has no aircraft around anymore because I keep taking it out. At this point, the Germans and the Japanese, here's my thing. If you want to still put up a big fight out here in the forward area and you lose, it's your collapse is that much quicker. Think of World War II when Hitler, he went for the dumb Kirk's Oriel battle. After that, the Russians just, they were up here in 1944, but after the collapse of the battle, it was just a massive rush to who can get to Germany first. Hitler wasted his troops on that Battle of the Bulge over here. After that, it's just a collapse. So I don't believe in doing that. I believe you still have the power and you put up a strategic defense. So that's why I'm just going to let them get this. I can't let them get him any further in here, and I got to put up a defense of this area that's better. The Japanese are looking weak here because they've been going over there and reinforcing out there. The forces are going to have to be thinned out and put in this area. So that's what I believe we need to do. I'm going to let the Americans do this. You know, the carriers, the Americans can keep up with me. Let's just keep defending, making him fight. I need to get by my aircraft, get it all in this area, build up the defense better here. And that's it. So I'm going to let him do that one. Now, the invasion succeeded. It was a counterattack, but he missed. I got it clean. This is supplied. This is supplied. However, post-combat phase, you can run supply now to newly taken hexes, which is this one. Just say again, any hex that you can supply in the initial determination phase, you have to supply that hex in the initial supply determination phase. You can't wait. However, stuff like this, that a hex that I just taken, if I want to use it next turn as an advanced airbase, I have to supply it in the post-combat supply phase. So right now, this is what the Japanese may want to stop. They don't want to see airplanes or ships operating out of this. So the Americans are going to try to supply this, and then I need to decide what to do if I were the Japanese, how to stop it. First, let's see what the Americans commit to the supply. Remember, the Americans are holding this force back to watch that force. That's what you do. You can't just use all your ships and let him free. You always keep something holding back. But the Japanese may want to commit to this fight and not let the Americans get supply up here. So we'll see how that goes. So the Americans run supply from Cairns with 6 ships protecting it because he knows he has these 6. He sees the Japanese 6 here. The Japanese choose to intercept with the 6, but the Japanese want to win the battle. So they put more of the pressure on the Americans. They divide their task force up here, create another task force, 4, come down and say they're going to intercept. Now the Americans, again, they're here to watch those forces, especially when the Japanese turn comes. You have to protect your stuff. So either the Americans divide their force and come out, but because he has to roll a 1 or a 2, I'm going to let him go with that. I would rather keep, he even weakened his force some more. I'd rather him keep this force watching over there. So we're going to let him go. This interception is automatic. This one he has to roll a 1 or a 2. And it's a miss. So it cost the Japanese nothing. It goes back. And we have a naval battle here, 6-on-6. I'll come back and tell you what. So out of the 6 ships, the Americans lost 3. The Japanese lost 3. So they both lost 3. But the Americans lost the battle because of they had more that aborted the battle. So it went 3 rounds. The Americans were done. So this is isolated. Japanese succeed in isolating this in the post-supply phase. So that's it. Now we move to unit construction for the Americans. And I'll take the British and Japanese turn. The British and the Chinese. Well, one of the things that I'm living by is here is, now the Americans are just sending reinforcements right into their captured ports here. And that's one change I make on the German setup. Right here, originally the airborne drop captured the port and were able to SR troops in right away. We need to put a unit here or here to be adjacent to this port, and then you already have the forces up here which would prevent any SRs through those ports. So next time we need to set up like that. But anyways, seeing overwhelming American and British forces breaking through here in France. If you try to fight them and stay up there, my philosophy is you're gonna lose. The Germans researched fortification forts, so all the way up to here, this line, and not only do you have this river, but you have a line. I say the defense has to be put there. They're getting beat here. It costs too many forces to be way out here. They can hold a smaller defensive area if they just start a strategic withdrawal, especially right here in this area where it's the smallest point. I think we're going to have to start strategically withdrawing. We're doing, you know, all we got to do is hold on and not lose our stuff. We can't let these break through. They're just busting through. They got too much power. If I can, I'd like to kill a tank here. That way I can get supply right here, at least free up some of these guys. And then I need to build a line here. So that's what I'll do is the Germans. We're gonna have Italy hold this spot here. Now he does have a lot of pieces that are vulnerable down here, and I don't know if I want to waste even my air doing any of that. But it's the Germans' turn. We're gonna set up more defensive stuff. We got a lot of dead to buy back. Our money is the weakest it's ever been. So we'll see what we got. I think that wraps up our gameplay. It's winter. The Allies are going to go. We're going to, you know, the Americans are pretty stymied there. They don't even have Italy out of the war yet. And the Russians were held back by all the extra German troops. And over here, the Japanese did their job. We'll have to think of some things. That's the Axis gameplay. For the Allies, we'll have to think of a couple things. I know for the Americans, we should get flexible deployment and all. We'll have it in an overview at the end of the last video of everything we should try to accomplish that we learned during this play that we didn't really do, and things that really help you out if you do them. So that's the end of the Global War game, Avalon Hill. Great game.